Good morning, good morning, good morning to you wherever you are. We are so grateful for another Sunday. We are so grateful to be in the first Sunday of the year 2021. Let's give God some much due praise and much due honor for bringing us to this moment. Wherever you are, if you are in your living room couch, if you're standing in your kitchen, if you're driving and you're in your car, wherever you are, pull over, step aside, take some time to hit the share button. Hit the like button, because we want to give someone the good news of the gospel on the first Sunday of the year. Because when we receive a good thing, we don't just hold on to it for ourselves, but we share it out so that the gospel can be further, so the good news can be further. And if you have been watching us for any length of time, you know that when the word comes forth from this pulpit, it is the unadulterated gospel. And that is what the world needs to hear. So hit the share button, hit like, and I challenge each of you, tag somebody in the comments, type someone's name so that they can get the service automatically. Let us go to God in prayer. Father, we are so grateful. We are so grateful because we understand that you brought us to the first Sunday of 2021. And we don't take it for granted. God, as the days go by and the minutes go by and the seconds go by, you are showing us that time does not stop. Things keep going on, but you stay the same. You remain the same. Even when the seasons change and even when people change, you have not changed. In 2025, you will be the same God. In 2050, you will be the same God. You are the same, and we are so grateful because your faithfulness never fails us. God, we thank you for your people who are in this place, who have prepared their hearts and their minds to give you the worship and praise that you deserve. Father, we ask that you forgive each and every one of us for anything that we have done against your will. And Father, we love you so much that you don't hold our mistakes over our head. Your Son's blood wipes our slate clean, and we are grateful. God, I pray for everyone who's watching, everyone who's listening. God, I pray for every household represented on the line this morning. God, give us the word that you have for us. The sermon series is Return to God. So God, we are returning to you. In our hearts, we return to you. In our actions, we return to you. In our deeds, we return to you. God, we are returning to you. We pray for the word that's going to come forth through Pastor Monk. God, give him preaching power. Give him the clarity that he needs to proclaim your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So the song says, there is a sweet anointing in this sanctuary. There is a stillness in the atmosphere. We have set the atmosphere in this place already because we brought God with us. And if he is with you, you can set the atmosphere in your home as well. You can set the atmosphere wherever you go. When you bring God with you, if God is here with you, he's wherever you go. And we are so grateful that he is omnipresent. If I go to the grocery store, he's not waiting at home. He goes with us wherever we are. So in this sanctuary, God is here. Come on, let us sing. There is a sweet anointing in this sanctuary. There is a stillness in the atmosphere. Come and lay.
For in the sanctuary,
is here. Come on and sing it with us. Come on, praise team, let them hear.
There is a sweet anointing in this sanctuary.
There is a stillness, in the atmosphere. To take it from the top again. There is
a sweet,
sing it,
anointing in this sanctuary. There is a stillness in the atmosphere.
Come and lay down.
Listen to that. Come and lay down.
Come and lay down the burdens you have carried.
For in this sanctuary.
For in the sanctuary.
God is here.
God is here.
Come on, wherever you are, God is there. Wherever you are, he is telling you on this Sunday morning, you don't have to go into 2021 like you did in 2020. Come and lay down those things that have weighed you down. Come and lay down your low self-esteem. Come and lay it down. Come and lay down your childhood traumas. Come and lay them down. Say that softly. Come and lay down.
Come and lay down.
Listen to God this morning.
He
wants you to understand that in order for you to live in the new, you have to kill the old you. Every morning you have to wake up and say that I am walking in the newness of God. And if I'm walking in the newness, that means I have to lay down everything that is not like him.
The burdens you
Say that to yourself. Say, I will lay down.
I will lay down the burdens I have carried.
Come on, say it to yourself. I will lay down, the burdens that I've carried. Say it with the say, I will lay down. Come on, let's build that up. Come on. Say, I will lay down everything that is not like you, God. So grateful that God gives us the opportunity to make worship time personal. And as we are going to Him and we are laying down those things that He says we don't have to carry anymore, He wants you to know that when you lay it down, there is mercy that endures. When you lay it down, there is grace that will be by your side. And His grace and His mercy are forever faithful. And we say, great is your mercy towards me. Listen here, we are going into a new year. And we are going into the new year in a mindset that is individualistic. And what do I mean by that? I mean that we are going to take this year and we are going to focus in on our individual relationship with God. Not our corporate relationship, not how our relationship with God is through our family and through how we do worship and through what. No, individually, I will return to God. Individually.
Great is your mercy towards me. Your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercies I see day after day, forever faithful towards me, and you're always providing for. Great is your mercy towards me. Great is your grace. Help me say, help me say.
Great is your mercy towards me.
Come on and say it. Your loving kindness.
Your loving kindness towards me.
Your tender mercy.
Your tender mercy I see.
Day after day.
Day after day.
Forever faithful.
Forever faithful towards me.
Always providing.
Always providing for me.
Great is your mercy.
Great is your mercy towards me.
Now come on and sing it with us.
Great.
You've got the gist
grace
of the song. Come on, come on, praise team. Let's say it again.
Great is your mercy,
your mercy
towards me. Your loving kindness,
your loving kindness, loving kindness towards me.
Your
your grace.
Great is your grace.
Come on, we're going to sing it again. And we want you to sing it with us.
Great is your mercy towards me.
Your loving kindness.
Your loving kindness towards me.
Your tender mercy.
Your tender mercy I see.
Day after day.
Day after day.
Forever faithful you are.
Forever faithful towards me.
Always providing.
Always providing for me.
Great is your mercy.
Great is your mercy.
Come on, we're going to say it again like we mean it. Great is your grace. Come on and say, great is your mercy, Jesus. It's because of your mercy that I am here. It's because of your loving kindness, your loving kindness.
Your tender mercy I see.
Day after day. Reflect on his mercy. Just reflect on his grace. Reflect on the fact that he did not give you the punishment that you deserve. If we just sit right there, we don't have to go any further. Great is your mercy. How merciful you have been towards me. How your mercy carried me. It carried me. Ooh, oh, ooh. Great is, great is, great is, great is, great is, great is. Come on, let's say, great is your mercy. Worship a great and merciful God. Continue to give him what you have. You know, when we were a kid and we would hear them say, if I had 10,000 tongues, I couldn't praise him enough. And as a kid, we thought that was funny. But when you come of age and you look through the catalog of how he's been merciful, and you look through the catalog of how his grace has carried you, and you look through the catalog of how he has always been loving towards you, and then that becomes your witness. If I had 10,000 tongues, if I had 10,000 hands, I couldn't clap enough, I couldn't say enough about the goodness of God. How he has kept me from danger, seen and unseen. How he has provided at times when I thought there was nothing there. How he has made a way when I didn't deserve a way to be made. He is ever faithful. He is ever merciful. He is forever gracious to us. And in this year of 2021, Father, I promise you as your daughter that I will return to you in every facet of my life. When it comes to business ideas, I return to you. When it comes to ministry, I return to you. When it comes to raising my family, I return to you. I will not take another step without your direction. So wherever you are, band, keep playing, and let them worship you at home. Great is your mercy, great is your grace. Kindness towards me,
your tender mercy I see. Day after day.
Amen. Wherever you are, would you continue to sing that song with them? Great is your mercy towards me.
Always providing for me.
Do you hear that? They say always providing for me.
Great is your grace.
Always providing for me.
Is your mercy
always, always. He never stops providing. He never stops being a father because of the things that you have done. He never stops being a father because of the things that you thought, the things that you said when you decided to walk away. But he's always providing.
Faithful towards me.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Always providing.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
For me. Great is your mercy towards me.
Man, if you would just keep playing here for just a moment. Listen, I know this is the first Sunday of 2021, and we are grateful to make it to this point in our lives for God to grace us this far. But earlier, the praise team was singing to you and I about trusting God with laying our burdens down with Him. We may be saying, some of you may be saying, well, preacher, I've tried trusting other people with my concerns, and they messed over on me. I tried other things. I invested my money in places. I developed relationships with people and began to trust them, and it just didn't work out. And I want us on this particular Sunday, before we even dive into the sermon, listen to these words of Jesus, of our Lord and Savior. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28. We are a Bible-believing church, and I want you to set your eyes on this wherever you are. Our media team doesn't have this for you to see it on the screen. This is why you want to have your phone, your Bible readily available to be able to look at God's word with us. Let's look at the words of our Lord of what he says here. Whenever you see in your Bible red ink on a white background or in your screen or in your Bible, these are the words of our Lord himself. And he says, come to me. Listen to that genuineness. Come to me. Right now, you're far away from him, but his command is to come to me. This is not some weak, pale, flimsy Jesus. This is the strong and matchless King who says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You've been toiling enough. The load has been heavy enough already doing it by yourself. And our God's plea to you today is just come to me. Don't worry about what it looks like. Don't worry about the baggage. Don't worry about how much you messed up and you are the cause of your own pain. Just come. Just come to me. And here's what our God says to you and I. He wants you to come with your baggage, but look at what he says here out of his word. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Listen, this morning, before we just dive into, we're going to prepare ourselves to take communion. Those of you who are at home who have your cracker or juice. But while our band is playing, someone may not believe it if they hear it from me. And this is what I love about this virtual environment. We want to give you the opportunity while they are still playing to just simply type about the burdens you gave to God and how he gave you rest. That if they hear it from not just the preacher, but they hear it from other saints that are on this live, those that are watching on YouTube, those who are watching on embcmilwaukee.org, those that are watching on facebook.com, and you're watching this service, would you type the burdens that you gave to the Lord and how he gave you rest? Would you tell the story about how your utility bills began to add up and you couldn't have sleepless nights? But when you gave it over to Jesus, how he gave you rest. For that married woman, that married man who you were having sleepless nights as your spouse told you that enough is enough, and they decided and thought about walking out, and you gave it over to the Lord and he gave you rest. For that parent that has been having sleepless nights with the loss of a child, and it could be they physically are dead, but they are just wayward and you don't know where they are. But as you gave it over to the Lord, he gave you rest. This is why we sing this song to our great God. Great is your mercy. Great is your mercy, I sing. Great is your grace. Ooh, great is his grace. Grace, my brothers and sisters, is this undeserved favor we get from God. We can never earn it. You can never pay for it. I don't care how good Big Mama and Granddaddy were. They can't hand down to you God's grace. Because if he was to hand it down for what they have already used up, what they deserve, but our God is so generous, he gives to you and I new grace every single morning, Lord Jesus. And I wish I had a few hundred people out there that could say, preacher, I know I burnt up my grace some years ago, but God has been faithful. He has been kind. He has been just. That he gave me some more grace this morning. And tomorrow he's going to give me some more grace. And the day after that, he's going to give me some more grace. Yes, Lord. Listen, before we even take communion this morning, and I want to just give our praise team a chance and our musicians. We want you, wherever you are, would you raise your hands? Would you tell God thank you for his grace he's extended to you all throughout 2020, all that he's already poured out into you in 2021? It's his grace, his mercy. And my brother, my sister, I don't care how mean, how difficult life may be. And don't think for one moment the preacher don't have his own problems, his own challenges. But if you just simply open your eyes, you will see the grace of our God. The kindness of our God. You will see how he's been providing over and over and over and over and over and over again. Would you tell our God thank you? Would you tell him thank you? Listen, don't use my words. You tell him thank you. Tell him for how he provided. Tell him thank you for his protection. And if you need a reminder about the goodness and the provision of our God, guess what? There are almost 300,000 people who have died of one single virus, and you're not one of them. I don't care if you're listening to me and you're in a hospital bed sick right now. Guess what? God didn't say enough is enough and stopped your life from continuing on, but he gave you another day. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Great is your grace. Great is your grace towards me. Listen, before we push on here, can we just sing this one final time? Great is your mercy towards me. And would you do this? Would you put your hands over your chest and remind yourself, God, great is your grace towards me.
Your loving kindness towards me.
You might be at home and ain't nobody else there with you, so this ain't the time to tell your neighbor. This is the time to minister to yourself. Great is your grace. Day after day, forever faithful. And you're always providing.
Always providing for me.
Great is your grace.
Great is your mercy towards me.
Great is your grace.
Great is your grace.
Let's give God praise wherever you are. Let's put those hands together. The redeemed of the Lord ought to say so. The people who live on your block ought to know today is the day that I worship my great God. I give them praise every day. But when I get a chance to connect with the saints, even if it's virtually, that I read somewhere over in the Bible that it says that the redeemed of the Lord ought to say so. They ought to open up their mouths and understand that God says, if you won't give me praise, I'll cause some rocks to cry out. And I don't know about you, but my God's been too good to me to let some rocks cry out on my behalf. The rocks ain't got a song that Reverend Clay Evans came up with that says, I have been redeemed, bought with the price. Jesus has changed my whole life. We got a song that the angels don't have. We have been redeemed. Hey man, I'm so grateful today for God bringing us to the first Sunday of 2021. Can we give God praise for making it this far? Amen. God, thank you for letting us make it to 2021. We're so grateful and thankful to our great God, to you, the Ephesians family, and also we're grateful for all of our visitors. We recognize there are hundreds, if not millions, of churches you could be worshiping with this morning. The Lord led you to join us this morning. We're so grateful and thankful for you being with us this morning and worshiping our great God together. And we're so grateful that as we are beginning the first Sunday of 2021, even in this virtual environment, God has been continuing to add to our church family. And so can we give God praise for all of the new members who became a part of Ephesians in 2020, and even in 2021, you all, I mean, literally after the benediction was given, we had a couple new family members who joined our church, and we're so grateful and thankful for those that have become part of our Ephesians family here. Listen, this morning, there's one special announcement that we have. We want to remind you all that this coming Wednesday, and every Wednesday at 7 p.m., to join us for our Bible study at 7 p.m. And I want to encourage you to join us this coming Wednesday as we're going to begin a new teaching this coming Wednesday at 7 p.m. And I'm so excited about where the Lord is going to be leading us as a church throughout this year. And starting with the theme of returning to God, before we push on with our worship experience this morning, we got one special announcement from some special fellas this morning. Pay attention to your screens.
Hey, ABC family, we're welcoming you to go sledding with us today at 2:30 p.m. And also, there are going to be a lot of volunteers there to watch us. And if you are 12, you could still go as long as you're having fun. So, yeah, just welcoming you to go sledding. And if you don't want to, it's okay, but we're going there at 2:30 p.m.
Mia is at the hill behind the tennis court. Lay dry. See you soon.
See you soon.
Hey.
Grateful. We're so grateful for those young men. Can we give God praise for them? Amen. Listen, this is an impromptu thing. We want to invite all of our EMBC family to meet us today at 2:30. Listen, your pastor likes to have fun, and I miss all of our children. You hear what I'm saying? All of our children that are here at Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church. And also, those of you who are watching, you got kids or even the adults, you want to come hang with us. We're going to go sledding at the hill right across the street from Collectivo, the coffee house at Lake Drive. If you go down Lincoln Memorial Drive, you can't miss Collectivo Coffee. It's right on the corner. And right across the street is a set of tennis courts. And to the north of the tennis courts, directly right behind you, can't miss it, it's going to be a bunch of people out there, is a nice size hill. I don't want to say huge, I don't want to intimidate some of you all, but it's a nice size hill for us to be out there. We have some sleds, we have some volunteers that will be there, and parents, we want you to know this is not one of the moments you drop your kids off and keep on rolling. We need you to hang out with us. We're going to have some volunteers that will be there with us. And we'll also have a few sleds also and some treats for our kids. And I just think it's just appropriate just to give our kids an opportunity for them to be able to see each other. I know it's been difficult for many of us not to be able to be in the sanctuary together. But wouldn't it be fantastic if we all met out there and the people were like, man, are y'all all one big family? We're like, absolutely, yeah. Man, our daddy is God Almighty. And we here as a church to be out here enjoying the outdoors together. So from 2:30 until 3:30, we'll be out there. I want to encourage you all who are coming with us, do not park in the parking lot of Collectivo. Park right across the street. There's a huge open public parking space for you to park into, and you just need to cross the street. Please do it safely, as there are quite a few cars that go up and down the street on Lincoln Memorial Drive. Today, we want to prepare to take communion, as this is the first Sunday of 2021. And so those of you who are part of our Ephesians family, if you're not, I want to ask for you to visit our website and update your contact information if you didn't receive a text message from the church of just reminding you that we'll be taking communion together today to get your cracker or bread or juice to prepare to take the Lord's Supper with us this morning. And so in preparation for that, we want to look at Paul's instructions to us in taking communion, and then we're going to prepare ourselves to give to the Lord our tithe and our very best offering to the Lord this morning. Paul says to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 30, he says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly. And for this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep." As we prepare to take the Lord's Supper together this morning, we want you to pause and to remember our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to think about the sacrifice he has made on the cross for us, his body being beaten for us, his body being whipped for us, crown of thorns being placed upon his head, him being spit upon for us, being buried for us, and then resurrected for us. But most importantly, some of us have been guilty of just stopping there, of just him being buried, crucified, buried, and resurrected. But the great celebration for those of us that have placed our faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and as Savior is that he is coming back again. And so this morning, we want you to take your cracker, your bread, and let us break it in remembrance of his body being broken for us. And now let us eat the bread or cracker together. And now, to remember the blood that has been sacrificed for us, let us take the drink and let us drink together. Let us pray, and then we will prepare to give to the Lord the tithe and offering. Father in heaven, thank you now for this privilege of being able to take this communion this morning. And I ask you to forgive me for overlooking to ask you to bless these articles as we have consumed them this morning. But Lord, we know that in us taking this as you commanded us, it is in remembrance of who you are, We ask now that you would have sanctified, let no harm come to us, and transform it from its carnal use to a spiritual use. Thank you for you being with us in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, now we want to prepare ourselves to give to the Lord our best in our tithes and offering to the Lord. And I want to challenge you, my brother and my sister, as we prepare to give, to make sure that you email us at info@embcmilwaukee.org if you prefer to receive your giving statement via email. And then also to provide us with your address if you have moved, let's say even in the last 20 years. Let's just do it that way to make it as easy as possible. Because the one thing we don't want to do is we don't want to mail a statement to your home and we have an improper address. So sir and ma'am, please email us at info@embcmilwaukee.org. And we want to challenge you to trust the Lord that this is good ground to sow into. In 2020, there are just too many things to even name that we as a church have done in helping to serve people and building God's kingdom. And one of the benefits of your giving, you're seeing it right now through the use of technology, that we want to continue to improve this worship experience virtually. And I'm going to say to those of you who are out there right now, you want to give and sow, understanding that there are so many more people to reach with the good news of Jesus Christ. And we as a church, we don't want to be behind the world as it pertains to the production of what you see, the quality of what you see and experience. We don't want there to be any distractions that will prohibit individuals who do not know Jesus Christ from hearing about the good news of Jesus Christ. And so to help us in that effort, we want to encourage you to join us in giving, as this church has helped the poor and the needy. We have been on the leading out front as it pertains to racial and even political issues. I mean, and I'm just going to stop because I could go on and on. But we want you to trust God and give to him this morning. And so in preparing to give to the Lord this morning, I want to remind you, first and foremost, Jesus says, if you have an ought with a brother or sister, and get to the temple and there remember that you have a problem with them, leave your tithe and offering there. Go get it straight. Then come back and give it to the Lord. He wants you and I to give to him from a cheerful heart, with clean hands, pure hands, not with bitterness, not with strife going on. And listen, if you made the effort to resolve those relationships with that person and they refuse to take steps to resolve whatever the issue is that went on with them, listen, you've done your part. It's time to move on. But then we want to give to God the tithe and the offering first. Leviticus 27 and 30 says to you and I, the tithe is mine, says the Lord. And so we give to the Lord his tithe and your offering. Anything above the 10% that God has blessed you with is your offering. That means if you have a job or you have multiple jobs, whatever you collect a check from, the first 10%, and let me say this here for those of you who are wondering, just starting out the year, 10% is your gross, not your net. Because God says, the tithe is mine, meaning the tithe is mine even before Uncle Sam got his. You see, Uncle Sam don't ask you if you're going to give it to him. He takes it. But God doesn't do that to you and I. And the reason is because he wants you and I to give it freely and cheerfully. So we give to him the tithe and the offering. After you give to him the tithe and the offering, you pay yourself. You set aside money for savings. Then you pay your bills on time. If you're prepared to give to the Lord this morning, I ask if you would to grab your phone, your offering envelope, your device, and let's hold it high. Let's ask the Lord to bless our gifts this year as we begin 2021. Father in heaven, thank you now for this great privilege of being able to give back to you what you so graciously have given to us. We thank you that we know that, yes, we did work the job, but if you did not give us the mind or the energy to get out the bed and to go to work, if you didn't give us the ingenuity to own the business, to have the properties, we wouldn't have what we have. And we thank you for your faithfulness, because we could be like tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands who have no stream of income. But we thank you for what your hands have provided. And so, Lord, we ask you to be pleased with these gifts that we give back to you. We ask you to bless it now, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. Return it back to us in the manner in which we have given to you. And Lord, this year, as we push on into 2021, we're asking for you to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. God, we're asking for you to bless us as a church to free us of this mortgage. Bless us to pay it off this year in 2021. And we don't know how it's going to happen, but we're coming to you boldly to the throne of grace, asking for you to do this, to empower us, to strengthen us, to do more ministry for you. We thank you for you doing these things now in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Also, before we dive into God's word, I want to encourage those of you who are members of the Ephesians Church to email our church office at info@embcmilwaukee.org to request to receive a link to our church's business meeting. Listen, this is so important for you to do this. We want to talk about the vision God has given me for us as a church as we move forward and the great things that we have in store moving into 2021. So again, please email us at info@embcmilwaukee.org so that we can send that link to you to be a part of our church's business meeting. Listen, today as we begin this new year for the month of January, God has laid on my heart for us to focus in a series of sermons to help us in returning back to our great God. And so in starting this, starting tomorrow, we will begin with our annual time of prayer and fasting. And so as you see on your screen right now, starting tomorrow in our time of fasting, we will abstain from food until noon. So it's consuming water only. We want to encourage those of you who have a very strict diet to consult your physician before joining us in this time of fasting and abstaining from food. For the week of January 4th to the 10th, we're going to read Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. And our prayer focus is going to be taking necessary action. So as we're praying, we're going to be praying, soliciting God to give us insight into the necessary action we need to take to return to him. And then our confession for the week is, no person or thing will come between me and the Lord. You're going to say that out loud. No person or thing will come between me and the Lord. Say it with me. No person or thing will come between me and the Lord. One more time. No person or thing will come between me and the Lord. And all this week, that's going to be our time of prayer, of reading God's word, and our confession throughout the week, because we are going to be a church that returns back to God because we want to see him work in our lives, and he has been more than good to us throughout this year. And so I want to encourage you, my brother, my sister, tag someone in this. I want to encourage those of you who have not already to like and to share this worship experience. Call your brother, your sister, your friend, your colleague, and tell them to join in with you this morning as we dive into God's word. I want you to meet me in Nehemiah chapter 9. Nehemiah chapter 9, as we return back to Nehemiah, we focus on rebuilding our city, and now we want to focus on returning back to our great God. And so Nehemiah chapter 9, we're going to be reading verses 1 through 5. I'm going to be reading from the New American Standard Bible. And Nehemiah chapter 9. Verses 1 through 5. And it says these words. Now on the 24th day of this month, the sons of Israel assembled with fasting and sackcloth and with dirt upon them. The descendants of Israel separated themselves from all foreigners and stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. And while they stood in their place, they read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a fourth of the day. And for another fourth, they confessed and worshiped the Lord their God. Now, on the Levites' platform stood Jeshua, Benai, Kadmiel, Shabana, Buni, Shabani, Bani, Shani, and they cried with a loud voice to the Lord their God. Then the Levites, Jeshua, Kadmiel, Benai, Hashbani, Shabiah, Hodiah, Shabiah, and Bethaniah said, "Arise, bless the Lord your God forever and ever. Oh, may your glorious name be blessed and exalted above all blessing and praise." Listen, for the time that you and I have together this morning and starting this series of returning to God, I want to title this text this morning in our exchange just simply, "Take care of unfinished business." You may be seated wherever you are. Take care of unfinished business. Let us bow our heads in a word of prayer. God of grace and God of glory, we do praise and magnify your name. We thank you for the strength and the power that is in your name. And so now, Lord God, we come to you asking for you to forgive us. We, your children, have sinned against you. And Lord, this morning we're asking for you to unveil our eyes, to soften our hearts, to remove the scales from our eyes, that we may see the things that we started to do with you last year, but have left them undone. Transform us. Revive us, Lord God. Draw us close back to you. And I pray now in Jesus' name, you would tear down every apprehension that whoever is watching or listening will have to this sermon and returning back to you or starting a journey with you. Save someone this morning, encourage someone this morning, uplift someone this morning. We thank you for you doing these things in your son Jesus' name, amen. Could you imagine it, my dear brothers and sisters? It is a revival like none other. Thousands from a city flood to hear the good news of Jesus Christ be proclaimed. They have watched urban renewal take place. They have watched the ashes of a once destroyed city rise from the dust to revival, to a place of security and a place where once many felt unsafe and unsure. My dear brothers and sisters, without having to talk about anything else, this is the situation happening in the nation of Israel. They are returning from a time of reaping what they have sown. They are returning from a time that God has given them grace in the eyes of another leader. To return from their time of exile, of being removed from the place that God has destined for them, to a place to pay for their misdeeds. And so, my brothers and sisters, that in the midst of all of this happening, we come upon a people whose hearts have been moved by the reading of God's word. It sounds very much like many of us that throughout the course of 2020, we heard sermon after sermon that pricked our hearts. Some of them caused us to weep. Some of them caused us to repent. Some of them caused for us to start making commitments to reading our word, to praying more, to singing songs to God more frequently than we have in the past. But we only just started to do it, and we never continued in it. This, my brothers and sisters, is the status of Israel during this time, that they have heard the word of God be read to them. As you read Nehemiah chapter 8, you soon discover that the scribe Ezra begins reading God's word to the people, and when they simply hear the word of God be read, they began to weep. Is that you, my brother, my sister, that you can count the number of times in 2020 when you heard the sermon, when God pricked your heart, that you wept, you rededicated yourself, you rejoined a church, you started walking with God, but in the midst of that, you made those decisions off of emotions, but not with a commitment. And here this morning, God is here to make you and I aware that it's time to take care of unfinished business. Here, my brothers and sisters, we see that the nation of Israel, they began the seventh month hearing the word of God be read, and they weep. And Ezra has to tell them, no, 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 this is not a time of weeping, because this is a holy time. This is a time for you and I to celebrate the goodness of our God. They spend the rest of the month, that on the 10th day, it is the Day of Atonement, according to Leviticus 23, 26 through 28. On the 15th day, they celebrate the Festival of Booths, which is located in Leviticus chapter 23, verses 33 through 36. And then on the 23rd day of the month, there would be another holy convocation. But here we discover that in verses 1 through 2, that simply mourning and crying over your sin is only genuine if it produces action. Oh, Lord Jesus. I'll say it again. Mourning, crying tears, weeping, walking down the aisle of the church to give your hand to the preacher and your heart to the Lord is only genuine if it produces action. Some may be saying, well, hey, preacher, how do you know if my actions are genuine? Well, it can be told if your actions are genuine based on the level of action that you take. See, this level of action must be taken because spiritual growth is dependent on a willingness to be specific and honest about our weaknesses and our failures, and therefore all distractions must be set aside. Look here with me at Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 2. It says, now on the 24th day of this month, the sons of Israel assembled with fasting and sackcloth and with dirt upon them. The descendants of Israel separated themselves from all foreigners and stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. Here we see a people that it wasn't just simply a one-time encounter with God's word that they began to change. Can I say to you, my brothers and sisters, that you didn't get yourself into the predicament of the sin that has you swallowed up and tied up and tangled up in just a one-time encounter. But here God shows you and I the power and the magnitude of his word. That when his people spend time reading his word, when his people spend time meditating on his word. Now listen, I was going to push on here for a moment, but I feel the Holy Spirit having to speak directly to someone this morning. Listen, the time of returning back to God is not simply listening to Christian music only. It's not reciting church jargon and pieces of what you hear the preacher say, but the power, the potency of transformation comes from a healthy daily exposure to God's word. Now, I know there's a few of you all don't like me now because you said, preacher, why do I got to read the word? Because we see that when these people spent, listen to me closely, 23 days every day reading God's word, that then it led to change. You don't hear what I'm saying? 23 consistent days of exposure to God's word, to reading his word, meditating, putting your life under the microscope of scripture to dissect what in my life needs to change. And as they do this, of their own willingness, they make a decision to say, you know what? First and foremost, we married some people we weren't supposed to. But pump your brakes before you run down to Milwaukee County Courthouse and go get papers to separate yourself from your spouse. These men and women understood that the cause of them walking away from God were the relationships they got themselves entangled to. Oh, Lord Jesus. See, there's some of us that don't want to be honest. We got some friends, some boos, some babes, some homies, some bros, some sis that lay in the cut there. They are, we call them our ride or die. But after having exposure to God's word, we soon discover that some of those people are nothing but distractions. You try to get close to God, they're pulling on your coattail, pulling you the other way. You try to put down the substance to walk away from it because he says, touch not, taste not the unclean thing. And when you decide to walk away from it, they're the ones pushing it in front of you. And after having this healthy exposure, the nation of Israel makes a decision on their own. What kind of church will we have when the people of God recognize that in their personal time that they spend with God, that it's time for me to have a little morning time with God? Not waiting on a preacher to call a prayer meeting. Not waiting for Bible study to make it to the altar. But pushing aside the dining room table, letting the kids know it's time to be silent. And in my own home, with nobody else around, I spend time mourning over my own personal failures with God. And all this month, we're going to discover that what brings them to this place of mourning is that they discover throughout this chapter, and we will look at it week after week, of God's divine blessing. They weep because they have received blessings that have continued in spite of their rebellion. They mourn and weep and put on sackcloth because they rebel even in spite of the blessing. And then they mourn because they are appealing for deliverance because they recognize that they've been missing out on the blessings of God when he stops blessing them. See, my dear brothers and sisters, reviewing the scripture in light of your mistakes is the potency for repentance. And this is what may make many of us avoid it inevitably, which leads to repentance, which is simply the trigger for transformation. See, my dear brothers and sisters, true repentance will not come without a healthy exposure to God's word. And so this reading of the law provokes both repentance for national sin, and it's also an appeal that the promises of the covenant need to be fulfilled in their lives. And so we see in Nehemiah chapter 9 a prayer of confession and also a cry to God. See, taking these steps reveals to you and I that we are guilty as charged of apostasy. We are guilty as charged that our loyalty to God has been abandoned, but the weightier matter is how our loyalty or how his loyalty to us has never stopped. And then we pause to review and to reflect about how good our God has been. But you and I discover here in verses 3 that a committed time to reading God's word is the only fuel for confession and worship. Look here with me at verse 3. It says, while they stood in their place, they read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a fourth of the day. And another fourth they confessed and worshiped their Lord. Here we get a chance to see, my dear brothers and sisters, that in having this consistent time of reading God's word every day, this became the fuel for their confession and for their worship. Now, before you scroll away, take a look and listen to the time that they commit to reading God's word. While they stood in their place, verse 3 of Nehemiah chapter 9, they read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a fourth of the day. Your math, and you're such a smart, astute congregation. What is 4 divided by 24? 6 hours. When is the last time you committed an hour to God? When is the last time, instead of giving God a drive-by of personal time to spend with him, that you set aside time, you put it in your calendar, you let others know that this time that I'm spending is going to be committed time to spend with the Lord? That in this 6 hours they spent, because they recognize they've walked away from God, that then transformation begins to happen. I get it. I totally understand it now. The reason some of you all, when we were back in this sacred space worshiping our great God, and the reason that you were mean mug the praise team, and even me, that I thank God that I ain't never scared of none one of y'all. The reason you have such a mean look on your face is because you really haven't had exposure to God's word. See, true exposure, consistent exposure to God's word, no one would have to pump and prime you to give God praise. You would come in on your own accord and recognize, I am guilty as charged of apostasy before a holy and mighty God. I am guilty of lying, saying that I am a disciple when I truly have not been a follower of his all my little life. I deserve to be in a burning hell. I don't deserve a savior to die on the cross for me. But when I recognize that if it had not been for the grace of God, I would be on my way destined to hell. And so, pausing to read God's word, and then to meditate on God's word, is like stopping in the kitchen after a long day of just hanging out in the house, not taking care of chores that you have in your house, and then walking to the kitchen or walking to the laundry room and standing there and looking at the accumulation of the dirty dishes in the sink. Looking at the size of it. Smelling how it stinks. Picking up the shirt and looking at the stains that have soiled and set in those nice fine garments, and you begin to weep because you look at it and you say, how did I let things get this bad? This, my brothers and sisters, is where our God is calling you and I to this year as we return to him. Make note of this, that first and foremost, we need to read God's word. After you read his word, the second thing you and I need to do is we need to pause and reflect on his word. Psalm 1 tells you and I that the blessed man, the blessed woman, they meditate on God's word day and night. They walk around reciting God's word to themselves, thinking on it like you and I do with the lyrics of our favorite song. Read, reflect, then next worship. Because when you read and you reflect and you look on your own life, the natural result that should happen when you and I read and reflect is to worship and to thank our God for what he has already done. It is to worship him and to thank him for in anticipation for the things that you don't yet possess but are already on the way. It is to thank God for the time of sickness and not in denial that you are sick, but thanking him in advance for the healing that is on the way, okay? It's recognizing that even though I don't have a job and no money's coming into the house, that if I'm better than birds, if I'm better than grass, than lilies of the field, I'm not going to worry about what tomorrow's going to be because God's already got in his word already. He already got it taken care of. So we read, we reflect, we worship, and lastly, we confess. We tell God about our own messy situations. We tell God about our mess ups. So one, we read his word for understanding. Hear me, child of God, this morning, because we're going to slow down because we want to start the year off correctly. It's not about how much of God's word you read over 2021, but reading it to get an understanding. If you read one chapter and it takes you all week for you to pause to read it, and what you will soon discover is that even in you reading one chapter, there could be four or five words you just can't even get over them because it's resonating so loudly, so well with you that you're pondering over it all the week long. And so then we reflect on your past actions. And not only reflect on your past actions, but you look at the status of your life to reflect and see, what is the trajectory that my life is heading on right now? And does it align with God's word? Because see, here is the scary thing that many of us don't want to do. We don't want to put our own lives under the microscope of Scripture and to have to recognize there's some changes that need to be made in our lives. Then that brings us to read, reflect, worship. And in this, we worship God for his faithfulness. And then lastly, confess your personal failures that you have missed to meet the mark that has been set by our Savior, Jesus Christ. But lastly, in taking care of unfinished business, we see here that people still need leaders to lead them in this process of taking care of unfinished business. That we see in verses 4 and 5, that we discover that only leaders who are guilty as charged are qualified to lead you to resolve unfinished business. As you look at verses 4 and 5, I know there's just a laundry list of names there that many of you all are saying, man, I thought my family members had some unique names. I thought, you know, the way they went about putting her name and his name together, I ain't never seen that before. That was unique to pronounce. But preacher, I think the Bible got some names here that tops all of that stuff that I heard. But there's one name I want to highlight here for you. And that is in verse 5, Pethahiah. Pethahiah, my dear brothers and sisters that you see there, he is a Levitical priest that the Bible shows you and I that in Ezra chapter 8, he is one of the priests that is guilty of marrying foreign women. Now, I know that may have just went over someone's head there, but this shows how bad things have gotten in the nation of Israel, that the preachers here, the Levitical priests, the ones responsible for telling God's people about his word, are not even keeping it themselves. Here is a man, who's telling the people that you and I are only supposed to link up with believers. Oh, Lord Jesus. There are people out there right now who are watching Herd over and over and over again. I mean, it's screaming in your ears of even hearing his voice say to you, reading right out of God's word, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And you wish to God you would have listened when the word of God was read, but you were so consumed in lust that now you got to pay the penalty being married to that individual who has not placed their faith in Jesus Christ as Savior and as Lord. And it is a hellish situation because you're trying to walk with God, but that person can't understand it or comprehend it, and they don't want no parts of it because they are not walking with God. But this man is not a leader who stands before the people and at some point in preaching the sermon is not convicted by his own words. That here, standing before the people to cry and to pray out to our great God, is not simply a bunch of men whose records are squeaky clean. But here is a man who stands up that says, I'm guilty as charged. He stands up before the people to lead them in a time to say, arise, bless the Lord your God forever and ever. Oh, may your glorious name be blessed and exalted above all blessing and praise. See, my dear brothers and sisters, the reason you and I can return to God specifically here at the Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church, because you don't have a preacher standing before you saying that he has always done all the right things all the time. But I stand up here just like you, that I am guilty as charged before a holy and mighty God. I've messed up over and over and over again. There have been times where even in my own life, the very thing that I preach to you about, to abstain from doing in God's word, I stand here guilty as charged. But I know that I don't stand here alone. I know that there are hundreds who are watching and will hear this, that they too are guilty of defying God's word, that you're guilty of breaking his law. You heard the word be preached to you. You cried tears of remorse and guilt because of the things that you have done. And you went back and decided to do it again. And it's time for us to cry out to our great God and say, God, we're sorry for what we've done. And we're done playing games. We got some unfinished business we got to take care of. We got some friends we got to let go. We got some habits we got to keep up. We got to commit ourselves to time of prayer and fasting. We've got to commit ourselves and our finances back to the Lord. Some of you all out there right now, you're saying, whoa, preacher, hold on. I'll recommit my finances back to the Lord after Tuesday. And there's a few of you all out there right now, you know where I'm going saying Tuesday. The Mega Millions is however many number millions in the hundreds of millions of dollars. That Reverend, I'm going to commit my resources to the Lord after I just give it one more crack. I'm going to just let the machine just pick a few of them. $5 ain't going to hurt. But you didn't give God $5. And so today, as we end this time of sharing, I want to encourage you this morning before we get started and move into the rest of this year. Would you pause wherever you are? Would you bless the Lord for his glorious name? Would you give him praise and glory that is due his name for his wondrous deeds, for the provision that he has provided? That he didn't give you the punishment that you rightfully deserve. Would you give him praise and thanks that you're guilty as charged? And I don't care what you say. You say, well, man, how is this preacher going to stand up here and talk to me? He is guilty as charged. You know why? Because I understand God's got grace for that. And if you think you got it all together and that you don't have any faults or failures, and I want to say to those of you who are out there right now, don't try to figure out what my sin is. You got enough of it in your own life to try to fix your own stuff than to try to piece together what my stuff is. But here our God wants us to pause going into 2021 and not simply be moved by emotion, but having a healthy exposure to God's word. Right now, wherever you are, would you raise your hands and would you talk to our God right now, wherever you are, and tell him you're sorry for the things you've done? Would you ask him to give you the strength day by day to read his word every day? Would you think on your own life and recognizing that you're not that busy that you can't pause, that after reading God's word, to at least meditate on what you read? And then to give him a time of worship and thanks for what he revealed to you in his word. And then being able to confess the promises of God. And even your own guilt and shame that you have done before a holy and a righteous God. Would you do that now? Don't wait on me, because I need to take my own time. And while our musicians are playing, would you worship God wherever you are? Listen, there may be someone who's watching this morning. You may be saying, "Preacher, I recognize I messed up, but I know I just can't simply just admit that I've messed up, but I'm in need of a Savior." Listen, our God makes it this simple. He says to you and I, Romans 10 and 9, that if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that God has raised Jesus from the dead, he says that you shall be saved. My brother, my sister, for God to save you is simply being willing to believe that Jesus Christ is God's Son who died on the cross for your sins, that he was buried, and the third day God the Father raised him from the dead. And that after him raising him from the dead, the Bible says he ascended to heaven and is now seated at the right hand of God and is waiting on the time of his Father to return back here to rule and to reign. This morning, if you're willing to believe that and to confess it with your mouth, would you pray this prayer with me? Would you say, "Dear God, I recognize I'm a sinner. Ask for you to save me now. I believe that your son Jesus died on the cross for my sins. I believe that he was buried. I believe that he was resurrected for me. And I ask for you to be my Savior and my Lord from this day forward." If you prayed that prayer with us, you can type that in the comment section to let us know, or to visit embcmilwaukee.org, click on the tab that says "Become a Member," and a member of our team will get back to you as quickly as possible to welcome you to be part of the Ephesians family. Can we give God praise for the word this morning, for God speaking to our heart this morning? Amen. We thank God for his faithfulness and his kindness towards us. We want to encourage you to stay tuned with us all throughout this month. And church, want to remind you that tomorrow we'll start our time of prayer and fasting throughout this month. I want to say to you, listen, hear me closely. We saw from God's word that when the people of God recognize that they have walked away from God, they take unusual steps that others may not even understand. Can you imagine how difficult it may have been for some of them that have friends that they knew were not walking with God, and they cut off all communication with them? And for some of us right now, we're saying, "Well, what, preacher, to noon? My lunch is at 11 o'clock and I can't eat my lunch at my desk. How much, what if I just take a break and eat from 11 until 11:15 and then give God extra 30 minutes afterwards. That ain't what he told me. It's fasting from the time you get up until noon. If your diet will allow it. If you got concerns or questions about it, call your physician. But for the rest of you, I want you to just to trust us. For some of you all, God may be speaking to your heart the moment we show the image for fasting. And he said, I don't want you to fast till noon. I want you to fast at 3 o'clock. I want you to fast until 5 p.m. There is something that, listen, let me hear me closely. The sacrifice doesn't even compare to the revelation and the blessing that God will give on the other side if you just be willing to trust him. Can I tell you something? The reason some of us are not getting the clarity and the direction that we're looking for is we got too many voices speaking to us that we can't hear the voice of God. And what he's trying to do is to get you and I in a place that we silence everything else, everyone else around us, that we can hear him clearly. Can I tell you something? I woke up this morning and it was something that was in my mind and my heart, and I was praying about it yesterday, and God was speaking to me. He said, well, this is all you need to do, son. Just do that. And I'm like, I'm arguing with God. Like, really? Like, I don't want to do that. And he's like, well, either you're going to do it or you deal with the repercussion that come with it. But see, God can talk to me like that. And for some of us that are watching right now, he's talking to us like that, but we don't want to trust him with the instruction he's given to us because we're comparing what this person would say and what that person would say and what my mama would say about it and what my boyfriend would think and how my friends would feel when I start cutting them off. He ain't worried about none of that. Starting tomorrow, from noon, from the time you wake up until noon, we're going to abstain from food. Just water only. Do yourself this favor. If you got to go into work tomorrow, you got a bunch of Zooms tomorrow for work and all this other kind of stuff, you got to help the kids with your homework, go buy yourself some gum and some mints today, because your breath is going to stink because you're going to be hungry. Especially those of you who are used to eating and snacking throughout the day like I am. Hey, and listen to me, child of God. Then we're going to pray and get going. Don't eat the whole pack of gum to try and fulfill the craving that you have of being hungry. And the mints, as the preacher said, I could have mints and gum. So you eating two packs of gum before noon. That ain't it. That's not it. And hear me. And then we're gonna go. I really mean this. We're gonna go. Because you have not heard the voice of God clearly, and I'm going to say this because I stand here guilty as charged. Don't find yourself getting tricked by the evil one to tell you you can end the fast early. Or you're only going to do it Monday through Friday. I'm only going to do it on Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. That ain't it. It's every day from the 4th. Until we end our time of fasting this month. As you're ready to go, I want to invite those of you who are watching to come join us down at the lakefront to go sledding. We'll have some snacks for our kids and for our adults that are there. If you have a sled, parents, we want to invite you to bring that sled. And I want, most importantly, want to ask you all to please be safe, as there are quite a few cars that go up and down Lincoln Memorial Drive. If you're concerned about this, the hill, I don't care how fast you are coming down that hill, if you go all the way to Lincoln Memorial Drive from coming down that hill, you got to have a jetpack on your back or something like that to get to the street. But it's a safe place, and it'll be a great time for those of us, for us to be able to see each other. I want to encourage you, please wear your mask. Please, sir, ma'am, come with your mask. Have your hat on, have your shoes, your socks. Our plan is to be out there for maybe about an hour or so, just to see each other and to have a good time. I want to encourage you to join us in the privilege of giving to the Lord, if you haven't already, by visiting the Givelify app or embcmilwaukee.org, and then to meet us on Wednesday at 7 p.m. for Bible study. Let us pray as we get ready to go. Father in heaven, thank you now for what our eyes have seen and our ears have heard. God, God, strengthen us all this month to take care of the unfinished business. God, I'm praying for your people now. I'm praying for even for Raymond Monk, that there are things in my life that need to be taken care of. And even as painful as it may be, even as uncomfortable as it may be, help us to take care of this unfinished business. And God, you've been speaking to some of us that it's not only just spiritual things we need to take care of. There are some of us that have unfinished business with creditors and debtors. We've been seeking you about becoming debt free and increasing our wealth, but you're already speaking to us that there are things we have to take care of. Give us the courage and the boldness to take care of those things. Help us to resolve the issues, the relationships with people who we've hurt, who we've harmed. And God, I pray now that you would help us to not simply be moved with tears only, but with genuine action that reflects that we have returned back to you. And I pray now for preaching power throughout this month, that I know that what you have to say to your people the rest of this month, the evil one will do his best to distract. But I pray right now, and I thank you for the boldness in the Holy Ghost, that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise up in judgment, it is already condemned in the name of Jesus. Thank you that no weapon formed against Winston or Camille shall be able to prosper. No weapon that's formed against the Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church, it will form, but it will not prosper. Thank you for it being destroyed right now in the name of Jesus. I thank you now, Lord God, for the revelation you will give to your people in this time of fasting. I thank you for the clarity they will receive. I thank you for the answers they've been seeking for. They will get them in this time of prayer, fasting, worship, and confession. Thank you now, Lord God, for the higher heights you're taking us to. And Father, I thank you that as you take us to higher heights, help us to be comfortable at the altitude. And God, as you raise us to higher altitudes, I pray now, Lord God, that we don't apologize for the places that you're taking us to. That we don't apologize to the people who couldn't go with us. But God, we thank you that you're taking us higher. We thank you for the expanse and the reach of this church going further. I thank you for the finances and the resources coming into the hands of your people. Give us wisdom now in how to steward it. Give us wisdom in how to steward the relationships. Thank you for you doing it now. Be with us now throughout this week and forevermore. In your son Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all. We look forward to seeing you all either this afternoon or Wednesday at 7 p.m.